This podcast is sponsored by A. Miller George Funeral Home, where each life is celebrated, and their sister company, Cremation London and Middlesex, both family-owned and operated. By Hyde Park Care Pharmacy. Experience the difference an independent pharmacy can make for you and your loved ones. Hyde Park Care Pharmacy offers personalized care, short wait time, very competitive pricing, easy transfer of your prescription, and much more. And by Molly Maid. During these times of COVID-19, it has never been more important to keep your family safe. With the Healthy Home Cleaning System, Molly Maid London is here to help. Make your home a healthy haven. Call Molly Maid London today. In this episode, we welcome womenist biblical scholar, the Reverend Dr. Will Gafney, professor of Hebrew Bible at Bright Divinity School in Fort Worth, Texas. She is the author of Womenist Midrash, A Reintroduction to Women of the Torah and of the Throne, numerous commentaries, and co-editor of The People's Bible and The People's Companion to the Bible. She is also the author of a women's lectionary for the whole church and translator of its biblical sections. The first two volumes, Year A and W, were published in August 2021. Volumes B and C are due in 2023 and 2024.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whenever and wherever you may be. We welcome you back to another edition of the Vicar's Crossing podcast. The Vicar's Crossing is a virtual space where faith intersects with the public square. My name is Rob Henderson, and I serve as priest at Holy Trinity St. Stephen's Anglican Church in London, Ontario.
Hello, Rob. How are you doing?
I'm good. Kevin, how are you?
Oh, Kevin, that's my name. My name is Kevin, and it rhymes with heaven and seven and 11. I'm up in the northwest corner of London, and I'm excited to be with folks today, and I got another purple friend here in the screen with me.
Yeah, we got the memo. My name is Ian. I'm a singer-songwriter, content creator, and the producer of this podcast who sends it out into the world.
He's the man.
All right. Yeah. It's good. Good to be back together again. This is our second last episode before the Christmas break.
Penultimate.
So we got a couple more coming up, including today. And today we are welcoming a wonderful guest into our podcast, The Vicar's Crossing, welcoming professor of Hebrew Bible at Bright Divinity School in Fort Worth, Texas, and author of the book, Womenist Midrash, A Reintroduction to Women of the Torah and of the Throne. Dr. Will Gafney is joining us today, Wilda Gafney, and we will be talking to Dr. Gafney coming up. She is also the author of A Woman's Lectionary for the Whole Church and translator of its biblical selections, the first two volumes, Year A and W.
Isn't that like the hamburger joint? No, it's not like that at all.
No, I was going to have a popcorn burger.
I never caught that when I put it in. Year A and Kevin Year W.
A and W, which is a standalone volume, and they were published in August, and volumes B and C are due out in 2023-24. And Dr. Gafney is an Episcopal priest and former Army chaplain and congregational pastor in the AME Zion Church.
She is a force to be reckoned with, to be honest. And I was holding up the Year W when I thought I was holding up the other one, but I realized the Midrash book is on my iPad. So,
okay.
just very dynamic. I've had the opportunity to hear Dr. Gafney a couple times on podcast, and wow. So we're really looking forward to and excited to have her here. A land acknowledgement before we begin, though, to acknowledge that the Vicar's Crossing is recorded on the traditional lands of the Anishinaabe, Haudenosaunee, Lenape, Walk, and Attawandaran peoples on the London on lands connected with the London Township and Somber Treaty of 1796 and the Dish with One Spoon Covenant Wampum. These lands continue to be home to diverse Indigenous peoples, whom we recognize as contemporary stewards of our land, Inuit, Métis, and First Nations, and we want to work together with all peoples to work towards reconciliation and putting painful past behind us.
And also want to take a moment to thank our sponsors here at the Vicar's Crossing. First, we say hello and thank you to A. Miller George Funeral Home, where each life is celebrated, and their sister company, Cremation London Middlesex, both family owned and operated. And many thanks, as always, to the support of Dave Mullen and everyone over at A. Miller George today.
Yes, and our thanks as well to Hyde Park Care Pharmacy, locally owned, locally operated, locally loved. And you know what they're doing over there?
What are they doing?
Immunization. Oh. So let's say that you need a booster, like I do.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Then you can go there and get your booster. Or wow. If you've not been vaccinated already, we won't debate with you why you haven't. But if you have, we're going to sell. If you haven't and you're ready now, we celebrate with you making the decision to finally get vaccinated. Go to Hyde Park Care Pharmacy. Carol Basada is there, and she'll jab you with a needle and help protect you against COVID.
Booyah. And last but certainly not least, you want to say a big, huge thank you to Molly Maid. Make your home a healthy haven. Call Molly Maid London today. And Trisha Lister was the person who hooked us up with that. So big thank you over there to them.
All right. Great. Good. Thanks, Ian. Thanks for cleaning that up for us.
Good one. Yes, nicely done, Rob.
Thank you. You're welcome. So that's great, guys. I think Dr. Gafney is here.
I think
I'm seeing things properly. So we're going to let her in, and we're going to talk to Dr. Gafney and get this conversation started on the Vicar's Crossing. And we are so happy today to welcome Dr. Will Gafney to the Vicar's Crossing podcast today, all the way from Texas. Dr. Gafney, welcome. We're glad you could be with us today. How are you?
I'm very well, and thank you so much for having me on.
Good. You're welcome. It's good to have you with us. We're looking forward to chatting about your book and books, plural.
Yeah.
So Kevin's going to kind of kick things off for us and get us underway here.
Yeah. Well, you're in Fort Worth.
That's correct.
And how is life in Fort Worth right now?
We had a surprising dip in temperatures to the 30s last night, but we're Texas, so we'll be in the 80s in 2 days.
You'll bounce back.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, if it makes you feel any better, it was snowing when we got up, but then we're in Canada and it snows all year. So
yeah.
There you go.
London, Ontario is not particularly warm today either. So we're all in the same state.
Yeah.
Once again, thank you for being with us. We wanted to chat a little bit about this new lectionary, which you've put together, which is amazing, which you've got behind you. And a little bit as well about the Womanist Midrash, which is just an incredible book. I had opportunity to sit and read last week. I learned so much and it was so helpful. And for those of us who are clergy, like myself and Rob, so much for us to sort of take away from all that and think about and include in liturgical preparation, preaching, and all that stuff. So it's just such a wonderfully helpful resource and resources that you're putting together. And we're gonna talk more about that. Before we go too far, though, like you are an incredibly good biblical scholar. You're a womanist. And in your book titled Womanist Midrash, you explain that Womanist Midrash is a set of interpretive practices, including translation, exegesis, and biblical interpretation that attends to marginalized characters in biblical narratives, especially women and girls, intentionally including and centering on non-Israelite peoples and enslaved persons. Womanist Midrash listens to and for their voices in and through the Hebrew Bible, while acknowledging that often the text does not speak or even intend to speak to or for them, let alone hear them. I'm just wondering if we can begin by giving listeners who wouldn't necessarily hang out in some of the more theological corners a better idea of what we mean when we say womanist, talk about womanist theology, and midrash for those who aren't familiar with the Jewish practice of midrash. Can you help our listeners pick up on some of that?
Certainly. There is no small irony that the title which best fit this book, Womanist Midrash, was composed of two words that are not widely recognized by non-specialists, mm-hmm. which publishers will tell you is a terrible thing to do.
Yeah, and they did, didn't they?
Perfect title. So absolutely. So let's back off of womanist theology, which is a common misunderstanding that womanism exists primarily as theology. Mm. Womanism is an overarching ideological, philosophical framework in the same way that feminism is, which is why you can have feminist anthropological studies and feminist literary studies. Mm. So womanism is a larger framework. Religious studies came into womanism through theology. So that is why it is often in the forefront of public memory, and those early womanist theologians were the first to do womanist biblical studies, and then trained biblical scholars began using a womanist lens womanist hermeneutic to do biblical scholarship. And so now we have a field of womanist biblical studies, womanist biblical scholarship, womanist biblical hermeneutics. To be a womanist is to be a Black feminist, to borrow from the ancestral definitions of Alice Walker, with all of her complicated and troubling comments since then. I always acknowledge that. Walker gave a beautiful illustration saying that womanist to feminist is like purple to lavender. Black women's feminism is a richer, deeper, thicker feminism, unencumbered, and now this is my own definition, unencumbered by the racism and classism that infects and plagues white feminism. So womanism is most simply Black women's feminism, but it is distinguished by being polyvalent, intersectional, addressing race and gender at a minimum, always, nearly always addressing class, sexuality, and other factors depending on the shape of the particular work. So womanism is a particular kind of rich and thick, deep Black women's feminism. Midrash is biblical interpretation. It comes from the Hebrew root that means to inquire in biblical Hebrew, but in rabbinic Hebrew, which is a very different language, in the way that contemporary Italian is a very different language from Latin, different number of steps, but similar pattern. Midrash is specifically biblical interpretation. It is, as you noted in your introduction, a Jewish practice of biblical interpretation that is deeply rooted in the text in Hebrew and has some cultural and historical rules and antecedents. I studied rabbinics when I did my PhD. That's one of the minor fields in which I write. And so I looked at some of the ways that the rabbis engage the text, some of the questions that they ask, and recognize that preachers in the Black preaching tradition make some of the same rhetorical moves, although without the layer of knowledge of the Hebrew text, sometimes at all, and not to the degree of the rabbis. And so I took my training and my life experience in those places and drew together my identity as a womanist, as a Black preacher in the Black preaching tradition of the Black church, and as a Hebrew biblical and rabbinic scholar, and held those two things together, doing a kind of deep dive into the biblical text in conversation with the ancient rabbinic way of engaging texts, but doing so with womanist sensibilities, centering the experiences and perspectives of Black women.
Okay, great. No, it's great. Let's continue on that thread then. We want, if we can, take a look at some of your midrash and the importance of women in the Hebrew Bible. And I wanted to start with asking about Sarah and the story of Abraham and Sarah. I think most of our listeners and those in our parishes certainly are familiar with Abraham and Sarah. So a little quote from your writing. Abram did not object to Sarai's seizure by Pharaoh. He relinquished her to Pharaoh and accepted a rich settlement for his loss. Her brother husband sold her to a man he knew would use her for sex. A hip-hop womanist reading of this text would say that he pimped her out. I think there is value in honoring Sarah as a survivor of sexual violence and domestic abuse and acknowledging her partner's complicity in that abuse. That is the plain truth for which womanist truth-telling calls. But we also know that Sarah, like many of us, as you point out, is a very complex character. And you continue and say that she later orchestrates Hagar's sexual abuse by Abraham and is party to and beneficiary of it. The biblical text makes plain the unwelcome truth that women participate in trafficking and sexual abuse of other women. So you make the case, Dr. Gafney, that Sarah's complexity can be iconic for contemporary religious readers who may not find themselves on a single side of a contrived, you know, privilege, peril, binary scale. Can you tell us a little bit more about how Sarah, and in all that complexity of her, has importance for modern day readers today, especially when they read those stories?
The importance that Sarah has is going to be determined by who the reader is and where they sit when they read. So for some, the Sarah and Abraham story is, as you named it, the Abraham and Sarah story. And it's a story about Abraham as a founder of a religious tradition who will be an ancestral figure and prophet in, and or prophet in three traditions. For others, Sarah and Abraham will be the parents of those who seek the way. For example, often those who convert to Judaism take the name of Sarah and Abraham as their parents in their naming formula. For yet others, Sarah is one of the so-called heroines of the Bible. She's a character who has a lot of text attached to her, and so she becomes an object of study. In some African-American readings, Sarah is, as Renita Weems has written of her, and as I write of her in part, representative of the white women who enslaved Black women, men, and children, who were complicit in forced breeding schemes and at the same time violently retributive to and against these women and girls who had no control over their own bodies and sexuality.
Yeah, it's incredible. And what I found reading the book was, because you move from Sarah to Hagar and then on to so many others, that what's really impressive in your writing, and you draw this out, of course, in the lectionary as well, which we're going to get to, but is just the scope of the number of women in Hebrew scripture and in the prophets and so on that we don't recognize in our own lectionary as it sits right now. So we want to talk about some of those before we go into talking about the lectionary, and some of the lesser known ones that our listeners will not necessarily recognize the name of when we speak of them. You point out in the introduction to your lectionary for the whole church that there's a great need to elevate stories of women in scripture, especially given that scripture is so androcentric, and it would appear that the creators of the lectionary make it even more so in terms of what we get to hear on Sundays. You point out that there are at a minimum 111 women named in Hebrew scriptures, and that does not account for the numbers of unnamed women and girls. And you point out, and I think this is right, if we had to ask any given person to name 10 women from Hebrew scripture, they probably struggle to do so. So coming back to discussing, we're going to come back to discuss this incredible lectionary in a bit, but I think it's fair to say that many people, while they remember, they will remember the story of Sarah and Abraham, and they will remember about Hagar. They're not going
not
to
always.
Not always.
Someone sharing with me online that they did a bit of a pageant in church, and the character of Hagar had a line and said, this is my baby and that's the daddy. And that an older woman in church said, Abraham, oh, you're bad. Like, this is new information to this woman. That, as someone taught introductory biblical studies for, we're going to say something like going on a quarter of a century. That is simply not the case. And in my professor voice, I am going to urge you to modify one piece of your language. We'll do more later with the lectionary, but I invite you to stop saying the lectionary. I invite you to talk about the dominant lectionary traditions, because there are the RCL and the Episcopal lectionary and the Catholic lectionary and the Orthodox lectionary and the narrative lectionary already. So there is not a lectionary.
Yeah, no, that'll tell you how conditioned I am and the rest of us too, right? So I appreciate that. So I was thinking about, like, you know, Rebecca, Leah, Sarah, names that sometimes at least people will recognize, lesser known names, less familiar characters like Bilhah and Zilpah. These two women, whose bodies were used to produce a full third, you write, of the 12 tribes of Israel, are often overlooked in prayers naming the matriarchs of Judaism and Christianity, often a footnote. In writing about how Bilhah is treated by Rachel, you speak to the parallels of modern women of privilege who travel to the two-thirds world, to India in particular, to pay surrogates to bear children at a tenth of the cost, for instance, of what they would pay in America or here in Canada, I would argue as well. Zilpah is presented as another pawn in the war for Jacob's attention and affection. I wonder if you can share with our readers more about these two women and these matriarchs of the 12th tribe of Israel and what their story bears for us.
Certainly. I use this teaching example. If we say that the trajectory of the Torah is the story of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and we present God as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, we're telling, for people who know the text or have some contact with the text, a familiar story. But if we say that God is the God of Hagar, Sarah, Keturah, and Abraham, Rebecca and Isaac, Rachel, Leah, Bilhah, Zilpah, and Jacob, we're telling a different story. We're telling a story that includes polygamy. We're telling a story that includes enslavement. We're telling a story that includes forced pregnancy and surrogacy. We're telling a different story. And we might liturgically make that claim that God is the God of Hagar and Sarah and Keturah, as well as Rebecca, Rachel, Leah, Bilhah, and Zilpah, along with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But would those women, would those enslaved women say that that God is their God, that the God of the men and women who said that they could do what they wanted with their bodies for their own benefit is their God? Now, Hagar, we have an entire narrative, a double narrative, about her relationship with the God of the people who would become to be known as Israel, and a very special relationship that she has. So if we're telling the story of this people and their God and their relationship to their God and their stories about their God, without naming all of the people in the play, in the pageant, then we're telling an incomplete story. And we're telling a theologically simplistic story that doesn't acknowledge the deep depravity of these characters and our own human depravity. So putting these people back on the page in which they already reside was a way to educate readers about the depth and breadth of these texts, and quite frankly, make them question the facile claims the text makes, and sometimes their preachers, and sometimes they make, about who God is and how God works in the world. For those who spend any time on social media, you will have seen, if it's not good news for the poor, it's not good news. If it's not good news for the enslaved, it's not good news. If it's not good news for the characters on the margins of scripture, it's not good news. If it's not good news, Canaanites, it's not good news. Right. If it's not good news for these women named and unnamed, it's not good news.
Amen.
I want to talk a little bit about Leviticus. And so I got to say, before I read this question that we prepared, a little content warning for our listeners, if you're having lunch right now, just get ready, okay? Because this is a great part of the question here. But we're going to talk about Leviticus. You point out that Leviticus, quote, concerns itself with everything your body squeezes or squirts out, extrudes, expels, leaks, or flakes, with the exception of snot, spittle, urine, feces, and vomit. And with this focus, Leviticus extends from the health and well-being of a single individual to the health and well-being of a whole people. And that's so important. You go on to argue that taking one's health and the health of one's community seriously as a religious obligation also means taking seriously one's own sexual health and the health of one's sexual partners. And you speak to these texts being read as a calling for sexually active persons to determine and monitor their HIV or other sexually transmitted infection status, share that information with their partners, use condoms as appropriate, and maintain sexual fidelity. Maintaining one's health with regard to other infections, such as colds, flu, tuberculosis, staph, and so on, may also be read from this text. The importance of health care providers, treatment, and prescription medication can be read from Leviticus as a public health text. So I had a bit of a two-part question here. The first is, you know, you wrote this pre-pandemic, understand. So I was wondering first if you could reflect on that aspect of Leviticus in our current climate right now, of course, because we're, you know, still in the midst of the COVID pandemic. And secondly, you point out that very few individual characters are actually named in Leviticus. There are some 24 verses in the book that specifically mention women, and many more in which women are included as part of the people of Israel. There are references to women giving birth and women with skin disease, sexually active women, women who do sex work, women who commit adultery. Can you share a little about these two sets of instructions as seen through a womanist reading?
Womanism is deeply rooted and invested in the well-being of the community. Mm. So it was natural for me to read it as a public health text, since all of the language about examination, inspection, and quarantine are public health practices. On the other side of the inauguration of the pandemic and the initial isolation phase, mm-hmm. it is clear to me that these basic principles of, I don't know what that is you have. I don't know why you have that orange spot on your arm. Mm-hmm. I don't know why your nose is running blue snot. You know, I don't know. You know why you and your body are doing all of these things. I think it would be better if you stayed over there and we stayed over here until we figure this thing out. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Isolation is effective with communicable diseases, if it is the right kind of isolation for the disease. Now, Iron Age people would not have known all of those things, but that general principle mm-hmm. that you shouldn't be in society while you've got the orange spots and the blue snot, that's a good solid principle.
Yeah. Hang on.
One of the reasons the pandemic is in the shape that it is in is that we never had a good solid isolation phase that was effectively broad enough, long enough, and deep enough to curtail transmission at a very early phase. Mm-hmm. So I see that public health text reading being valid and emerging as it does in Leviticus out of concern for the whole community. Because when the individuals, and there really aren't individuals per se, but when an individual family has a devastating illness, that affects the larger social group, which affects the next larger social group, which eventually affects the whole people.
I wanted to, it's Ian now. Sorry, I'm getting ahead of you, Ian.
It's okay. I was ready for you to go ahead, but
Ian's got to know about Rizpah, so go ahead, Ian.
Yeah, I'd like to ask you about Rizpah. She's the last of Saul's royal women whose name is preserved in scripture. She's a low status wife and a concubine. Rizpah's story is tragic and has a following among women as preachers.
Use the word concubine. You don't.
What was that?
Does it say concubine in there?
It does. So I've taken that from your text, not mine, but yes.
Really?
Yeah.
So my editor's pen, because I'm always arguing that low status wives are not concubines.
Okay. Oh, really?
All right. So maybe I'm using that because that's what is elsewhere.
Could be. And it was 2017. We've all evolved.
I was in this before. So I'm sorry I interrupted you.
It's okay.
Go ahead.
I just want to know if you could share her story with our listeners and say a little bit about the importance of lament, particularly lamenting the death of a young brown and black bodies.
Certainly. Rizpah is a character who is well known and beloved to black women, particularly black preaching women. She is the mother who defends the name and legacy of her sons when she can no longer defend and preserve their lives. While the Black Lives Matter movement became a public eruption after the killing of Trayvon Martin, the Black children, men, women, younger, have always been imperiled in this society. And so when Rizpa stands over the bodies of her sons, whose execution can be interpreted as a lynching, and keeps the wild animals from consuming their flesh so that their remains will stay out there to indict David, who has had them murdered to preserve his throne, but also to pay off a debt he believes that he owes. With all of that political machinations, this woman just stands there, keeping her rotting sons present before anyone who could see, very much the way that Mrs. Mamie Till did with her son's remains, Emmett Till. So this very powerful story, set in the context of a famine and a drought that does not get resolved until David relents, gets some shame, buries all of those bodies, and then the rain comes and there is some restoration in the community.
Yeah, I mentioned Emmett Till. Like, that actually is an incredible connection, right? Like, that story of standing over the body and doing that. I just actually looked, and I have to confess and apologize that what you write in here is the term is usually mistranslated as concubine. So thank you for the correction.
Thank you. I was on my way to getting to the exact page number.
Got it. While Ian was asking the question, I looked it up. So I own it. I see it there. I missed the mistranslated part. You were Pilgalesh. How do you say that?
Pilegish.
Pilegish, yeah. Is usually mistranslated, you write, as concubine, which denotes... mistranslates, which denotes a female sexual partner to whom a man has no legal ties. And then you go on to say, as wives with lower status than primary wives, their children were legitimate. The men were called husbands and their parents were called in-laws, all signaling legitimate marriage. So it's important that we get that right. So thank you for pointing that out.
Generations of my students would have been emailing you. I know. You just saved yourself.
You idiot Canadians. You got it all wrong. You don't know.
Whoops.
You need to spend some time in Dr. Gaffney's class. Anyway.
Ian, did I get to the to all of your questions? Because we had some diversions there.
Yeah.
You got it. Absolutely. Yeah,
thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah, I just think that the images, the connections there are really quite profound and powerful. Just to go back for a second, we're talking about the public health stuff. I'm just wondering if you have any reflection on the fact that, you know, this current variant that we're dealing with now is also a reflection of the fact that the wealthiest parts of the world are sitting on loads of vaccine, while we have the African continent with less than 1% of a vaccination rate right now. And when you start to begin to talk about that business of having care of the community in terms of caring for everybody, do you have any thought on that in terms of what that says about where we're at right now?
Certainly. The way in which community is identified is what is contingent here. Mm-hmm. For womanists, the community is global and cosmic. You know, so one of the newer fields in womanism is eco-womanism. Our community extends to the earth herself. Right?
Yeah.
You're talking about nation states. Communities start at artificially imposed borders, which were imposed for the benefit of people who won a particular set of battles and get to write histories and carve them in the face of land. So people do not see other folk as part of their community, even though we are all connecting airports away from the places where any pandemic is ravaging.
Yeah.
So this notion of we as politicians are going to protect this nation, viruses don't respect borders.
No.
And as long as anyone on the planet is moving between artificially constructed borders, then everyone on the planet is exposed.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that simple.
Yeah, and I think as it relates to our baptismal covenant to strive for the unity and peace of all people, respect the dignity of every human being, and love neighbor. We have to come to understand that these borders are so artificial, that and our globe has become so small in a way that our neighbor is, you know, not just the person across the street, but the person halfway around the world. And anyway, let's get on to the these incredible lectionaries. And I have to confess to you, I can't wait for the next two. But I'm going to have to wait because what a tremendous amount of work you must have put into this. I can't even imagine. I've had the opportunity. Sorry, say again.
Yes, let me tell you that the next two volumes will be begun in earnest. There's some prep work that's been done, but they'll be begun in earnest when I have completed the second volume of Womanist Midrash, which is focusing on the former and latter prophets. And
awesome. When is that one out?
I'm hoping to have that manuscript in the spring. I'm a couple hundred pages into it now.
Wow. Well, see, I got more stuff to look forward to reading, but I've had a very good look through year W, which is incredible. And I've begun to peruse year A. These lectionaries will no doubt trouble the waters in the way of good trouble. And I think that, In the introduction, you assert that it ought to be possible to tell the story of God and God's people, and this is tying back to something you said earlier, through the most marginalized characters in the text. Those of us who are preachers should be challenged by that, you write. This lectionary that you've created will cover years A, B, and C, and will feature the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, with John interwoven, as is the case in the Revised Common Lectionary. This work includes a companion text, fresh translations of the lessons for each Sunday, and the principal feast days in Holy Week, and the Feast of the Ever-Blessed Virgin Mary and Mary Magdalene. You have brief text commentaries on each day's lections and brief preaching commentaries on each day's lections as well. The choices of readings, Dr. Gafney, are so incredible and fresh. Perhaps most striking is your fresh translation in here. Tell us more about this. You've noted that scripture is read and heard and understood contextually. So how we translate words, and you a couple of examples here, like servant, which is often in scripture, which you more accurately say is slave, and you use that word with great intent. And those things really matter. You specifically, you preserve slave and place a servant, and you invite the reader to wrestle with that term and its influence on and in crafting and defending slavocracy. You also challenge the biblical language of light and white to mean good, and that of darkness and black to mean something negative. I was really taken by your tweet, actually, after the first Sunday of Advent. I'm trying to turn a phrase as works of darkness.
Yes. And it's in the collect. It was in the collect for the first Sunday's reading. And this is a conversation I've had every Advent for perhaps the last 10 years.
Yeah. Oh, really? Yeah. So say more on that. I mean, I'll come back to the question, but I just think that that's, and you've noted your name change on the thing. I just think it's great. It's calling us to account.
Yeah. So the human beings have a phobia of the dark. People who parent little people know this. Ancestral cultures look to sunrise, and those are often occasions of worship. People look to the seasons of the year when there's more sun. People become frightened when there are eclipses. So there is a natural dread of the dark, and humanity associates bad things with it sometimes, but not always. There's peoples know that good, rich, life-giving soil is black. In the scriptures, God dwells in thick darkness. The Hebrew scriptures use a variety of imagery for God. Sometimes light represents things that are good. Sometimes darkness represents things that are holy. But we don't live in that world. We live in a world where people sliced through the text and took the language of light and dark and applied them to people who they artificially categorized in races that did not exist in the world of the Bible.
Right.
And then they applied that religious language to them and said things like, we're going to go to the dark part of Africa and bring the light of Christ through enslavement and Christianity, right? So the world in which we read those texts and read prayers and liturgies built around those texts, like that collect from the Revised Common and Episcopal Lectionary, is a world in which, particularly now in the English-speaking world, Black means bad things. Black ball, Black male, Black sheep. So when we use those analogies of light and dark, which were not racist, which were not mapped onto human bodies, in a world where they have been mapped onto human bodies for more than 400 years, we are responsible for perpetuating that mapping. Where it's not just implicit, but it's explicit, because we're in churches where the stained glass windows don't look like the covers of the books. I don't know if your audience is seeing us.
Some are not.
So you can Google the covers of a women's lectionary for the whole church. So people are being formed in congregations where the holy people are being portrayed as white people, and that is intentional, disassociated from their African, Afro-Asiatic context, and where words light and dark are tied to peoples and their ill treatment. So on this side of all of that, we cannot innocently pray about light and dark. That doesn't mean we can't use those words, but we have to be very thoughtful about it. So in the lectionary, I talk about gloom and shadow and bleakness, which preserves that imagery of coming out of this this dense, foggy experience into the new light of day, bright and light. The Hebrew Bible doesn't use white. It doesn't fetishize white the way that our world does, but the darkness in the Hebrew Bible has been badly abused by Western biblical interpreters and intention. So I just disrupted.
No, it's fantastic. Now, what about a word a bit about two things, I guess. One of them is that use of slave or servant. And the other one is, you know, for women and girls to see themselves in the place of and close to the divine and to God, and to be able to have language that recognizes them, because so much of the language we focused on or used has elevated boys and men.
Certainly. Well, let's talk about enslavement. Both in biblical Hebrew and Koine Greek have a single primary word that people have translated in both ways. But when one looks at the estate of those persons being bought and sold, not having rights of liberty and autonomy of their bodies, not being able to choose to have sex or not have sex, even when their enslavement is a short period, as that is, they're going into understood to pay a debt, or for the 6 years before the Yovel, the Jubilee, there's legislation that if you have children during that period, you can't take those children with you. You are enslaved. Your children are the property of the person to whom you were enslaved. That's not servitude. English has multiple words. And so as translators, it is our responsibility to translate appropriately in the translation context, just as is our responsibility to deal with integrity with the originating language text. So a person who is bought, sold, impregnated at will, has no ownership of body or children, is just simply not a servant.
And with the girls, like, again, such a critical thing.
Language. So in the translations for this lectionary project, I use something I call gender expansive translation. I began that in Daughters of Miriam, in which I would use the women, children, and men of Israel rather than Israelites, so that every place where women and girls and boys, and now I'm much more careful to think about possibilities of non-binary presenting persons, that pulling them out of the plurals, which in biblical Hebrew, classical Hebrew, are really inclusive plurals. Most people were taught them as masculine plurals, but those grammars really need to be revised, because the fact is you could have 99 women and one man and use the same plural if you had 100 men. And you can use them cattywampus, so that when Ruth speaks, when Naomi speaks to Ruth and Orpah, she uses what was taught to me as the masculine plural. I always say she's speaking in New Jersey. You guys, guy is generally masculine, but we use it very flexibly now. So I expand these plural things. And one of the things it does is make really present some of the horrific violence. People have grown up, you know, Joshua smashed the Canaanites and the Perizzites and the Hivites. But when you say Joshua annihilated the women, children, and men of Canaan, you hear that differently. So I expand those. In the Psalms, I use feminine pronouns for the divine. I do this for a couple of reasons. That when God is introduced, or introduces God's self in Genesis, the first verb that pertains to the divine is a masculine verb, the verb to create. The second verb is a feminine verb. She was fluttering over the waters. God is presented with masculine and feminine language from the very beginning of Genesis, grammatical language. And then when you expand to imagery, you have things like the rock who gave birth to you in Deuteronomy, God asking Job, whose womb did Job think the sea came out of? That's obviously God's womb. At the same time, God says also, who fathered the rain? So God is doing some non-binary presentation themselves. So because we have this tradition already in the text, and God is arguably transcends gender, I choose to use feminine gender for the pronouns that are there, so that women, girls, and femme people and non-binary people will have the experience of praying to and hearing readings about a divine with whom they share a pronoun. For people for whom this has always been the case, this may seem inexplicable. But for people for whom this has never or rarely been the case, this is making live the claim that you are created in the image of the divine. When the person praying the psalm and the person writing the psalm and the divine to whom they reach are all sharing the same pronoun, and you can't sort out the she's because there's so many she's. That's not an experience that women and women identified people have had in the church. And when some of our saints and mystics transgressed gender lines, they still remained rooted in the masculine. So Blessed Juliana Christ our mother, and then goes on in a paragraph with 52 million he's in it.
Yes, that's right.
My ancestors saying, he is a father to the fatherless, and he is a mother to the motherless. I've taken the he's out of that. God is a father to the fatherless and a mother to the motherless, right? So we have this tradition. And so I have translated the scriptures in that way intentionally in the psalm. In the other readings, I use a variety of literary devices about how I identify God, but I do not sort of double down and settle into masculine language. There's no king language. There's no lord language. There's very little father language.
It's quite refreshing. One last translation for you, and it's a cultural one. I only know this because I have my wife's family is somewhere from the United States, but most Canadians have never heard the term cattywampus. And so I'm gonna have you tell people what that is.
Sort of crosswise intertangled. When you're knitting a thing and a cat has run through it and the strands are everywhere. Those are my visual preferences for cattywampus.
My wife's a knitter, and so I'm gonna really impress her today. Yeah. We have a cat, so this is perfect.
It might not officially be a knitting term, but that's what I get with it.
In Newfoundland, where I come from, we have. When I first heard it, I was like, "Oh, that's what we call scoways." We call it Newfoundland. We say scoways when everything is sort of all, you know. Anyway, yeah, but I just thought up. I better, because there will be somebody saying, Caddy Wampus.
There it is. Yeah. Well, this is going to be such a valuable resource for the church, Dr. Gafney, for sure. And you've identified several ways that it might and could be used in parish settings, in seminaries as well, designed for congregation and devotional life. And we have no doubt it will serve well in theological classrooms and preaching and worship. As a matter of fact, Kevin and I are going to a clericus or meeting next week of some of our clerical colleagues in our deanery. And this is certainly something we want to bring to their attention when we're talking about what we're doing. I wonder if you could share, though, a little bit about how you're hoping to see this work used. What's going to be a home run for you?
Well, honestly, I think we may be there this Advent, a number of congregations and individuals in terms of devotional practice adopted Year W. We didn't talk about Year W. Year W is a single year lectionary that goes through all four gospels that I wrote really thinking about folk in Baptist and Anabaptist traditions, non-denominational folk who didn't use a 3-year cycle, right, who might want to do a year of preaching women's texts, but would want a little more balance than, say, Year A, which is only going to be the Gospel of Matthew with a very few exceptions. Mm-hmm. So Year W is a single liturgical year, but it weaves through all of the Gospels. Mm-hmm. And so what is happening is that a number of congregations in Canada, in the United States, Church of Scotland, Church of England, Methodists, Lutherans, Presbyterians, have adopted Year W and are all walking through Advent together. If folk come to my webpage, willgafney.com, there's a tab for the lectionary, and each week there's a prompt and people are sharing collects, because I intentionally did not write collects. I wanted people who are designing worship, who I know are very busy, but I wanted them to write collects that fit their context after they sat with the text. But people are offering up collects. People created wreath lighting liturgies for Advent and are sharing that material there. So my hope of this being adopted has already been fulfilled.
Amen.
My next hope would be that after this sort of trial period with Year W, the other reason we're starting with Year W is this is Year C for everyone else.
Right.
So
right.
next year, Year A is already ready.
Yep.
And so prayerfully, Year B will be ready in time for B and C.
Well, it's awesome. And I thought perhaps a fitting way for us to close. I really like that, actually, when I saw in there that the colleagues were omitted. We've got an EFM Education for Ministry program here. And one of the exercises we found useful as a group is writing colleagues, right? Mm-hmm. Like it's that are very contextual and fit in the midst of what we're doing. But I thought a fitting way for us to close today will be to share this Sunday's lections from Year W, and we'll each take a turn to read some of these. And I'll just at the end reference back what the RCL is doing this week and show just how there's it, and again, refreshing. And I thought, why are we not doing this Advent? And I've already got a ton of ideas about how my community can engage these texts. So I'm so looking forward to that. So let's share some of these readings. The Year W, Advent 3, has Judges 13, 2 to 7, Psalm 115, verses 9 to 15, and 1 John 3, 1 to 3, and then Luke 1, 46 to 56. And I invite you all who are listening or watching to listen, to hear, and to just note the subtlety of language and how beautiful it can be for us to hear things fresh again, because this really is a refreshing translation.
All right. Well, I'll start it off then, reading from Judges, 13th chapter, verses 2 to 7. Now, there was a certain man from Zorah, of the tribe of the Danites, and his name was Manoah. His wife was barren, She had never given birth. And the messenger of the Holy One appeared to the woman and said to her, "Look now, you are barren, having never given birth. You shall conceive and give birth to a son. Now please be on guard not to drink wine or strong drink, and you shall not eat anything unclean. For look, you shall yet conceive and give birth to a son. No razor shall be upon his head, for a Nazarite to God shall the boy be from the womb, and he shall begin to deliver Israel from the hand of the Philistines." Then the woman came and spoke to her husband, saying, "Someone from God came to me, and their appearance was like that of a messenger of God, incredibly awesome. I did not ask the messenger from where they came, and their name did not tell me. Yet they said to me, 'You shall conceive and give birth to a son. Do not drink wine or strong drink, and do not eat anything taboo. For a Nazarite to God shall the boy be from the womb unto the day of his death.'"
And then Psalm 115, verses 9 to 15 are rendered as such. "Israel, trust in the Holy One of old. Their help and their shield is she. House of Aaron, trust in the Holy One of Sinai. Their help and their shield is she. You who revere the Holy One, trust in the Holy One. Their help and their shield is she. The Faithful One remembers us. She will bless. She will bless the house of Israel. She will bless the house of Aaron. She will bless those who revere God who is holy, both small and great. May the generous one add to increase you all, both you and your children. May you all be blessed by the ageless one, maker of heaven and the earth."
And this is John 3, verses 1 to 3. "See what kind of love has our Maker given to us, that we should be called children of God, and we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know God. Beloved, now are we God's children, and it has not yet been revealed what we will be. We do not know that when God is revealed, we shall be like God, for we shall see God just as God is, and everyone who has this hope in God purifies themselves just as God is pure."
The Magnificat, Luke chapter 1, verses 46 through 56. "My soul magnifies the Holy One, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For God has looked with favor on the lowliness of God's own womb slave. Surely, from now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is God's name. God's loving kindness is for those who fear God from generation to generation. God has shown the strength of God's own arm. God has scattered the arrogant in the intent of their hearts. God has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. God has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. God has helped God's own child Israel, a memorial to God's mercy. Just as God said to our mothers and fathers, to Hagar and Sarah and Abraham and to their descendants forever. And Mary remained with Elizabeth about 3 months, and then she returned to her home."
I just think those are magnificent. Wonderful. I mean, this week's lections in the Revised Common Lectionary, for those of you who are in those circles and following that, you'll remember it's what is often referred to as Gaudete Sunday or Joy Sunday. And so there's, you know, the "Sing, O Loud, Daughter Zion" from Zephaniah. "I will give thanks" is the canticle in place of the psalm. And Luke's gospel is the brood of vipers.
John shows up.
It's like, good Lord.
What's going on?
And so there's a stark contrast there. But I just found, as I sat and read through all the Advent ones, actually, just how I really was moved by this, by the movement of of it throughout. And again, it elevates different images, and it's really beautifully done. There's a different feel. Can you highlight for us with these readings for Advent 3 sort of what you were moving us towards in Advent?
Well, it's very difficult for me to say what I was doing on a specific day. I can talk about the cumulative.
Yeah, in broad context, I guess.
Well, one of the things I wanted to do with this Advent cycle was to take these stories that Christians in particular don't read and don't know, that there are a lot of theological assumptions about what happens in the New Testament being unique and first and only applying to Jesus or Mary. So the Advent lessons, the first lessons, are all stories of annunciations. And so there's one for every week. There's there's Hagar's, which is where we begin. There's Sarah's, there's Hannah's, and there's Samson's mother's. And so Mary's annunciation and Elizabeth's annunciation are in that larger scriptural tradition. So it's very important to me as a rhetorical student of Howard Thurman to show how this Jesus of the disinherited is the Jesus of the Israelite people. So that's what I'm doing writ large, building up to this Christmas story with these stories that are part of this rich legacy that are being built upon and interwoven in what will become the gospel and Christian tradition.
Well, this has been a great opportunity for us to learn and look forward to what's coming up. And Dr. Will Gafney has been our guest today. Dr. Gafney, thank you so much for being here. We remind everybody of the book's titles, Womanist Midrash, A Reintroduction to Women and the Torah, and Of the Throne, and also Women's Lectionary for the Whole Church, which we highly recommend and we'll be doing a deep dive into, I'm sure, over the years to come. So, Dr. Gafney, thank you so much for being on the Vicar's Crossing today.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you. And folks, go to our webpage, Books, Books, Books. You click on there and there'll be a direct link to be able to buy these books of Dr. Gaffney's. Thanks again.
And again, our thanks to Dr. Gafney for her time today and her wonderful work. And we'll look forward to chatting down the road, hopefully, and looking forward to those other volumes coming in the years to come. So, guys, that's the Vicar's Crossing for today. We want to thank our sponsors, as always, to A. Miller George Funeral Home, where each life is celebrated, and their sister company, Cremation London Middlesex, both family-owned and operated, to Hyde Park Care Pharmacy, locally owned, locally operated, locally loved, and to Molly Maid. Make your home a healthy haven. Call Molly Maid London today. And guys, be good out there. Be safe. I was just saying to the guys earlier, I hit the stores a little bit before we recorded today, and I'm still bruised a bit, but
yeah,
we can do this.
Hockey equipment?
We can do, yeah, I had my helmet
you
on.
You went to Costco, did you not?
Like, I mean, went
you
to Costco.
You can't go to Costco with their hockey equipment.
I know. Not, like, who's there at 10 o'clock right when they open?
Everyone.
Yeah, the whole city. I was, but I'm an idiot. So.
You know who you didn't see there?
Kevin.
That's right.
And Ian. Yeah, that's right. But anyway, 'tis the season. Guys, thanks very much. Good to see you. And I'm Rob Henderson from Holy Trinity St. Stephen's.
Kevin George, St. Aidan's Church.
My name is Ian. Thank you for listening.
And Kevin, remember to always look both ways.
Well, especially this time of year, Rob, and if you're in Costco, but yeah, you should always look both ways, as you say, before you cross the street.
Yeah, watch for those carts, man. People don't know how to drive carts in there.
Here comes a screaming cart.
Thank you for listening. Our hosts are Kevin George and Rob Henderson. Our producer and composer is myself, Ian, with original artwork done by Elizabeth Dodman. If you have any questions or want to know where to find us, tweet us at Vicar's Crossing or find us on Facebook at The Vicar's Crossing. If you have any other questions about anything heard on this podcast, leave us a comment or look in the description to find out more. Thanks. We'll be right back.